And good morning, afternoon. I guess it's afternoon at this point. Even in California, it's afternoon. My name is Dave Pedigo. I am the Senior Director of Emerging Technologies for CEDIA, and I am going to spend the next 45 minutes or so going over the 2016 preliminary findings of the size and scope study, which we have been doing since 2011. Utz, is that right? Was it 2011 that we started the size and scope? Utz Baldwin's idea was that, you know what, we really needed to size the market. How big is the actual market? So we could understand when we're talking to manufacturers, when home technology professionals are trying to get funding, that they can go to banks and talk about what the size of the market is. Absolutely. You can get a copy of it. In fact, if you want, afterwards, I'm happy to put it on a jump drive for you if you've got a computer, or we'll just send it to you, whatever is easiest. Absolutely, we will get that to you. So with that, we will kick this off. A couple things that I want to make clear is that when we're doing, and David, I'm just going to give you, we didn't use 4K display, so it might be a little fuzzy for you. So unless you're like me and need bifocals. So the sizing that we do, even though the data is collected for this year, the findings are for the year prior. And then we estimate what we think is going to be the final for this year. And I'm going to give some caveats about those in just a few minutes. And I'll also try to stay out of the way so people can take pictures. Just real quick, the methodology, which actually, Gene Sternberg, I think you were on the beginning groups trying to figure out what those methodologies were so that we could help do this sizing. So this is really a lot of your effort. So thank you for being here. So we opened up the study on June 22nd. We ran it for 60 days. We had 653 qualified dealers who responded to the survey, which is a good response. I think that it puts our margin of error into a pretty decent perspective. Now realize that when we do qualifying questions, we ask, so not everybody is a systems integrator. We also have electricians, IT professionals, security professionals. And so you will see that the margin of error fluctuates on specific questions because there might only be, let's say, 120 respondents who responded to a particular question because we've used the logic to take them out of the questions that aren't pertinent to them so that we don't skew the data. The categories that we covered, home theater and media rooms, distributed audio video, systems integration and control, lighting control and climate control, outdoor entertainment, motorized window treatments, IT computer home networking products, structured wiring, energy monitoring and management, voice control, power quality, and surge protection and video surveillance. And Stephanie, if you could come up here and then I'm gonna have you get a microphone. So let me introduce Stephanie Simopoulos. So Stephanie Simopoulos is Erica 2.0. For those of you who knew Erica, just so you know, and she doesn't she kind of look like her a little bit? So I think she's smarter, by the way. So Stephanie is our new market research manager. She's got an MBA. And so actually, I officially have taken over market research as of a couple weeks ago, and Stephanie works for me. And so Stephanie and I are going to kind of deliver this data together. You'll see that the graphs and charts are a little prettier as Stephanie is such a whiz at these charts. So with that, we'll get going. Methodology, again, as we said, make sure that you're keeping the margin of error into account. Whenever there is a really small sample size, we either needed to remove that data or we just had to have a large margin of error. So with this, here we go. Now this is actually kind of a newsworthy slide if you don't take some nuance into it, meaning that right now we have estimated that the size of the industry, the average gross revenue for our members, actually slightly declined in 2015 as compared to 2014, which would, on the average, on the beginning of it, you would think that this is a problem. It is not a problem. I see you shaking your head, Gene. Why would you say it's not a problem? A, it's not a significant difference. B, is that 2014 was an anomaly. I remember Ted and I talking after the size and scope last year, and we talked about the numbers almost being a little bit unrealistic. And actually, they really turned out to be realistic. What it was is that 2014 was a year that a lot of pent-up energy, a pent-up demand was released. And so when we look at 2015, even though 2015 was a little bit of a step back in average gross revenues, it's really still, I think, what was the number, Stephanie? 47 or 37% above the 2013 level. So still tremendous growth over a two-year period. And so what you're looking at with these two bars, one is this is the actual. So the actual revenue that we are sizing for home technology professionals was $2,161,556, lowered from $2.278 million in 2014. This line right here is the estimate. And we wanted to put this estimate in here because I think we have to temper expectations a little bit. So home technology professionals tend to be overly optimistic. That's why they're entrepreneurs. It's why people like Ken Erdman go into business, because they're optimistic about what they're going to do. So we have found, other than 2014, if you notice in 2014, the average home tech professional underestimated the amount of work that they were going to do. But what was it? 34%?
34%.
Yeah, so they underestimated 34%, but traditionally they have overestimated at around 15%. So you'll notice here that the home tech professionals are reporting that they think their revenue for year end 2016 is going to be $2.5 million. If you notice the dot that we've put here, Stephanie and I, along with Parks, thought we're not really comfortable with not at least saying you need to take that down. So they've averaged 15% higher. We said, let's put it at 7%. So somewhere between a $2.3 and $2.5 million is likely what the average revenue is going to be for home tech professionals in 2016. The good news is that while average companies, we saw a slight decline in the amount of average gross revenue for the median company, we saw revenues actually increase, and that revenue increased by $13,000, which is, I mean, it's not a huge amount, but it is a significant amount. And so if you see the year-end estimate of $1.046 million for 2015, and the estimate is $1.3 million for 2016, I'd temper that and take that down a little bit and probably multiply by about so you're probably more like 1.1 million, 1.15 million for your median revenue. So in reality, what that really means is the large companies maybe took a little bit of a step back, while the small companies stayed the same or even took a little bit of a step forward. Stephanie, is there anything that you'd like to add on this one?
Not really, Dave. I just wanted to say, you know, our system integrators are very overly optimistic.
You got to hold the mic right to your mouth.
Sorry. Our system integrators are overly optimistic. They estimated about 17% over. And we are a little more conservative with our estimates, with 7 to 10%.
Perfect. And you're going to have, it's almost like you're eating it. Okay. So, hold on 1 second. Nobody likes the Cowboys, so that's no problem. Okay, so now what this is here is this is the percentage of revenue from commercial versus residential work. So we'll see that honestly, the amount of work that our members are doing is relatively the same. It's within the margin of error. So about three quarters of their revenue comes from residential work. We've seen a little bit of an increase. You'll notice that on the all respondents, it's about the same. Maybe it's more, a little heavier on commercial than the home tech professionals. The one thing you'll notice, I love that Stephanie put this up here, is that collectively, respondents are more realistic when estimating as compared to home technology professionals. So our guys are a little bit more rose-colored glasses. But bottom line is, about three quarters of our work is coming from residential work. We did look at what the other work is. The overwhelming majority of the rest of the work is light commercial, but surprisingly, there is a small, but measurable, I think it's, I don't know, like 3 or 4% is industrial work, which is actually really surprising to me. I didn't think really any of our guys were doing industrial work. Anything to add, Stephanie? Okay. All right. So the next one is the number of projects completed. We also noticed, you don't see this because we didn't do the trending data, but in the trending data, the integrators over the last few years have overestimated the number of jobs they're going to complete. That is actually an area of a little bit of concern for me, because you would think that most of these members, because we're collecting the data from June to August, so we're getting the data really more than halfway through the year, that they'd have a decent idea of what their pipeline is like. But they're overly estimating a little bit. So right now, the number that we saw in 2015 was 56 jobs, which that's a substantial number. That means that our integrators are averaging a minimum of one job per week. What you'll see in a little bit, Stephanie put some slides together, we'll talk about home theater, and you can see where some of these average and medians come in. So the median projects, unlike in average and median dollars, median projects, the larger companies are more likely going to fall into this median number of projects where they're doing bigger jobs that take longer as compared to the smaller companies that are doing the smaller jobs. So AV integrators are doing a lot of work, 56 jobs in 2015, estimated 63 in 2016, and the only ones that really are greater are the electrical contractors, averaging 61 jobs and 67. Ken, how many jobs a year do you think you do as an AV and an electrical contractor? Around 40 is a one-man shop. So we're right on. Perfect. Stephanie, did you have anything to add?
Just that you'll see a little bit more of this later in the slide. We'll go a little deeper into this question as well.
Perfect. Okay, so this is one area where last year we didn't break down the information quite as much as we're going to today, which is the percentage of revenue that comes from equipment. And this number right here is a little bit concerning to me. So if you look at this axis right here, this is just the number, it's not a percentage, it's the number of respondents. Orange is all respondents, gray is systems integrators. But what we're talking about is how much of your revenue is coming from selling gear. And you're seeing that a healthy number, when we talk to experts, a healthy number is around 50%. We hear a lot of home tech professionals who talk about price erosion or commoditization, and that they're worried about the price of equipment that they sell bottoming out. And while we haven't seen that, what we know is that if there are price fluctuations and you are too heavily reliant upon the price of selling your equipment, if there is some disruptive product that comes out, it's going to wind up reducing your profitability. So I personally would like to see these numbers here going up, particularly the 40 to 49 and maybe the 50 to 59% going up. And those that 60, 70, almost 80% of their revenue is from selling equipment, they need to do better in their business, because they have to protect themselves against the evolution of technological changes. So right now, if you actually look at the median hasn't shifted from 56%, systems integrators 57%, but in 2012, that number was 50%, so it does fall outside of the margin of error. So we're seeing with innovation, new products coming out, and people more willing to spend money, that they're being a little less cautious in charging for their intellectual property. We want our members, you're smart, you're taking classes, you should be charging for your labor, for your design, for your project management. So this is one area that I have a little bit of concern. Anyone else? We're good?
A lot of our members have projects that are higher prices because we put in more time and effort into those. So I think that's really where this information is stemming from. But Dave is right. We do like to see that in the lower 50 to 59 range.
Yep. All right. So this is one of the lovely graphs that Stephanie put together here. And I love it because this really shows a little bit more kind of compelling data when it comes to home theaters. So first of all, I'm not going to speak about the next slide, but what we'll see is that there are some companies, a few, that are putting in 50, 75, even more than that home theaters in a year. In my opinion, if you're putting in 50 home theaters in a year, is it a home theater? Ken? No, it's not. It's a TV on a wall with speakers on the side. So the definition is probably off just a little bit. But what is most important is, I think if we look at this number, look at how many respondents we saw that are actually only doing 1 to 4, 5 to 9, or 10 to 14 home theaters in a year, and where home theater in general makes up just under 20% of annual gross revenue. You're seeing that it's a substantial part of their business. These are the bigger companies right here, or the bigger home theaters that are being put in. Some of those that have lead times of over a year, even 2 years at some point. And then so we see another good sweet spot here around the 20 to 24 theaters. But those that are following this long tail right here, those really, I think, are probably more home theater in a box or just displays on the wall. So the median number of home theaters that was installed, and that's home theater and media room, in 2015 was 8. And again, remember that the estimated number is always a little high. So the estimated number right now is 12. I'd say probably cut that in half and you'd probably be okay, and say that we'll probably see the median number at about 10 home theaters. Maybe it's a little bit more because of the innovation that's going on right now with high dynamic range displays, immersive audio, etc. Are there any questions, comments, concerns about this? Perfect. Well, then let's move on to the next one. Sorry. This is what's most encouraging to me, which is that, so for years and years, we've heard people talking about price erosion, commoditization, that everything's cheap and junky, etc. And it's not the case. 5 consecutive years, we have seen the average price and the median price of home theaters rise substantially. In fact, you know, going from 2011, the median home theater of $12,000 to $19,000 in 2015 really speaks volumes in my mind. Comments? Okay, so the audio installations, we kind of see again that the trend of our integrators are being overly optimistic as to what they think they're going to do versus what they do. But, and this is a little surprising to me, and I'm not sure why this happened, and I think we need to look into it a little bit, that the average and median number of audio installations decreased in 2015. So again, we did see a slight decrease in the average for average home theater, average gross revenue, but we saw an increase in median gross revenue. But I don't think that we can overlook this, that for some reason, whether it's saturation, it could be that maybe there are saturated products out on the market, or people are waiting for the next best thing. We saw a decrease from 34 average in 2014 to 30 in 2015, and we saw a decline in the average, or in the median, for installs in 2015 as well. So I'm not sure why. Does anyone have any insight as to why that would be? Ken? Here, let's give Ken a mic here.
In years past, we had a lot of multi-room systems. Nowadays, we're doing more single-room Sonos-type systems. I think that, for us, that skewed our number.
Perfect. Thank you. All right. So the next one is control systems installations. David, go ahead.
When it comes to your audio or your home theaters and questions,
yeah.
Did you define your terms in your survey?
We did define them, but the question is basically how you see it on top. So how many audio installations did you complete in 2016 and estimate in 2015?
Which would lead to some strange responses as people interpreted what they considered an audio system differently from how others interpret an audio, or what some people consider a home theater installation, some of your installers or your respondents, versus how others determine a home theater to you.
That is possible. That is definitely possible that people are interpreting the questions.
So you might need to define your terms more clearly for your survey.
Sure, that's possible. We do have 6 years of trending data on that, but you know what? We are gonna be looking at our research, I will say, just so you know, that the association over the next couple of years will be significantly ramping up our research, especially with Smarty Pants over here. So it's gonna be, we're going to be the kings of research in a couple of years.
And that's definitely something we're looking into.
Okay, so, one thing that was clear in the data that we saw was that the number of smart home installations is significantly increasing across all of the different market segments. So we do have in our full report, you will see that the report breaks down both what we would call the high level and low level home integrations installations. And you will see a little bit of dip in price in those, just because as we see competing products come in. But in general, the number of smart home, for lack of a better term, products going in, home installations for control and automation is increasing across all segments, particularly in the IT and professionals, which the sample is low, but the number went from 46% in 2014 to 75%-ish. In 2015. So we'll take this and break it down. The number right here, so for this question, basically, what items are you putting in? Whole house, multi-home control, energy management, HVAC, lighting, audio systems, and home theater. Right here, the one area that I find as a little bit interesting is that energy management is so low. It's still really low, and this is something that came up in a class I was teaching earlier. And the only thing that I can think of is that the reason why energy management is so low right now is because the price of energy is so low right now. So while there are people who are really environmentally conscious, they're crunchy granola like Ken Erdman, you know, kind of a hippie, you know, want to save the planet, at the end of the day, they care more about their wallet than they do about the planet. And so until we see energy prices, my speculation, until we see energy prices really starting to go up, you're not gonna see energy management as really a really incredibly valuable area for work. Yep.
Oh, he's got a question.
Yep.
Since the HVAC contractors are Nest Pros and that kind of thing, we're seeing HVAC contractors installing Nest and Ecobee and other smart thermostats, and so that work is not falling on our shoulders.
But and that's a good question, and one that I think Stephanie and I probably need to dig into a little bit more, because in my opinion, changing out a thermostat, as an example, is not specifically for energy monitoring and management. It is a reason, and we actually have, if you're here for the house study yesterday, one of the number one drivers was a reduction in energy, but it kind of falls in a little bit of a different category. Ted? There is a difference. Well, see, remember, energy management is more about the monitoring of it. So putting in sensors that measure the amount of current that's going through. Right. Yes and no. Like, yeah, I mean, and that's the technical difficulties. It gets a little bit difficult. But you're making the point that Ken is making is like thermostatic controls are a form of energy management. You're just not really monitoring it. Same thing with PV solar. How much PV solar are you doing these days? 2 a year, okay? So you both make a good point, and we'll go back and look at HVAC and see how we can put those together. This is probably more energy monitoring than it is energy management. Okay, so we're gonna dig a little deeper. So what we see here is that whole house multi-system control, about 85% roughly is whole house multi-system control. So that's roughly the number. So our guys are doing more of this control. Energy management's low, HVAC, most of our guys are still putting in the thermostats. I'll be interested to see what the number one brand for thermostats is. That'll be in our report. Lighting control is interesting in that lighting control is still over 80% of our members do lighting control, but it is not pushing the needle in the amount of average gross revenue. That's one area. Lighting control has been steadily roughly 7% of our members' annual gross revenue for years, which is completely different from what goes on in the UK, where lighting control makes up over a third of their annual gross revenue. And I'm not sure if it's just a cultural preference, I think. I can't pin it on anything else. We do, what's that? Well, it's so dark in England, you know, people need their lights. So it'll be interesting, Mike. Right, motorized shades, I spoke about this yesterday. I think our members are leaving an incredibly large amount of money on table with motorized shades. Motorized shades, the last number I saw, I don't recall looking at it this year, was it made up less than 2% of our members' annual gross revenue. Yeah, it is an asterisk. And it shouldn't be, because it's an incredibly profitable part of the business. But lighting control is different. Or we don't consider lighting control and shading control the same products. Yeah, thank you. And then 98% of our members are doing home theater, and about 95% are doing some form of distributed audio. Any questions, comments, concerns on this? Okay, so lighting control installations. The one thing that we are seeing is a steady rise in lighting control installations. Again, our guys are overestimating, and gals, because there are plenty of female installers, okay, are overestimating both in the average and the median. In fact, the median are a little bit more optimistic in the number of jobs that they're doing. In my personal opinion, I think that our members need to learn how to sell lighting control, because once it's in the house, you never want to go away from it. So I think this is just another area where a little more training is going to go a long way, and people are leaving money on the table. But so we did see an increase going from a 50% increase in number of lighting control jobs from 2013 to 2015. But statistically, looking at 2014, it's basically flat. Questions, comments, concerns? Stephanie, am I missing anything?
Nope, you got it all, Dave.
Awesome. Okay, so this is another lovely chart that Stephanie put together. We used to stack everything together, so it's a little harder to read. But so this is whole house control installations. So again, we look at that pent-up demand a little bit. So we went from 18 whole house control installations in 2013, 26 in 2015, and we saw a slight dip, again, I think within the margin of error, from 2014 to 2015, so we'd say it's flat. But again, flat from 14, which was an exceptional year, to 2015 is still great news. For all respondents, we also saw a drop. It's a little bit more of a significant drop from 2014 to 2015. And then again, both all respondents and systems integrators are very optimistic with the number of whole house control that's going into the home. I'd probably split the difference and say that we'll probably see somewhere around 27, 28 whole house control systems installed in 2016. Yes, sir. That is an amazing question. Actually, can I give you the microphone to ask that again, just because I want everyone? Well, basically your question was, that way I don't put you on the spot, was how much of this is the recovery versus how much is it in the growth of demand, consumer demand? Is that a great way? Okay, perfect. So I think there is a little bit of both, but if it were for me to weigh the two, I would say it's overwhelmingly the improvement in the economic conditions. So we happen to participate in the Harvard Joint Center for Housing Studies. And so in there, they have what's called the LIRA, the Leading Indicator of Remodeling Activity. And CEDIA has found that our growth is really very closely tied to the growth of remodeling in general. And you saw in 14, 15, really solid growth in the home improvement market. So while I'd like to say that we've got new, great, improved, amazing products, I think it's mostly because of the economic activity. I personally also tend to believe that 2012, 13, 14, and really most of 15, not all of it, were evolutionary years, meaning that the products that came out were iterations of other great products from years prior. 2016 is really shaping up, in my opinion, to be a revolutionary year, particularly with voice control, a little less tied to our market, but it is also incredibly revolutionary, is virtual and augmented reality. So those kind of things, I think, are going to drive us. Innovations in home audio. Dolby Atmos has certainly driven part of our market for home theaters. High dynamic range, Ultra HD, we'd love to get some content out there. That's driven a little bit as well. But if you were to put a gun to my head and say you got to pick between the two, I'm going to say the economic recovery is the overwhelming majority of the driver. Any other questions on this before we move forward? Okay, types of security. I found this a little bit interesting, that we have seen over the last few years a significant increase in the number of installations in IP cameras and installations. So IP cameras, we've seen an increase. Professionally monitored systems, we've seen an increase. And I think that part of that, honestly, it actually kind of goes back to your question before, has to do with there was a lot of unease in 2014, 2015, 2016, higher unemployment rates, although I don't think actually the numbers really bear out. People were perceiving higher crime rates, those kind of things. And so security is one of those things that you want to put in to make you feel safe and comfortable. So the two main areas of security that our members are putting in are video surveillance and professionally monitored systems. They still account for a very small percentage of what our members' annual gross revenue is. Hi, Jean. They are not. We do not break down by geographical region yet. Yet, I don't know if. Can I get back to you on that? So I would like ultimately to be able to break down some of the data in geographic regions. What I will say is that Stephanie and I are going to work on data for geographic reasons for housing starts and those kind of things and get some analysis. That's one of the things we want to provide to you, It's not just here's the data, but what does it mean for you? So I'll give you an example. I did some housing start data for San Francisco area. Do you realize that in the first half of 2016, not a single house in San Francisco sold for under $500,000? Not one, not even an outhouse sold for $500,000. So we do want to be able to do some breakdown geographically. I can't promise you that we'll get it, but we'll try. Again, we got a smart person here. She'll help us. I just stand up here to look pretty. Okay, so average number of home networking installations. This is another area that I found really surprising, and you can't discount this. You can't look at this and say that this is within the margin of error, that we have seen all respondents and systems integrators have installed fewer networks than before. And that, to me, is troubling. And the reason why it's troubling is I think that a lot of people look and think at a network and say, you know what, I can just buy it. A router is a router is a router. Guy, would you agree with that? Okay. Guy is our greatest volunteer from the UK. So, hi, Guy. Okay. A router is not a router is not a router. And we are putting more and more and more devices into the home. And the problem is that homeowners think that it is okay to use a big box router with these sophisticated products. I postulate, this is just me, that a lot of the home automation and control problems that we're seeing in people's homes are not based off of the products. It's based off of two things. One, poor programming, but two, is that people aren't putting in the right types of networks at home, and people are scared to tell somebody that they need to buy a $1,000 router. Sorry, it's the central nervous system of the home, and you need to do a better job selling the proper networks. And I can honestly tell you, it's not because there aren't people trained. For the last 8 years, CEDIA's most popular technical classes have been networking classes, and they're all hands-on. It's the salespeople not doing their job. Sorry, that's my high horse there. So outdoor entertainment is another area that I think our members could do a lot better job in. We spend most of our lives in a building. How many of you here spend at least 6 to 8 hours a day, waking hours inside a building? Okay? We need to be outside. We buy houses. We need to put more money into outdoor installations. Right now, the median outdoor installation is 5, yet we average, median number for jobs is 40. So only, you know, it just a tiny bit is going into outdoor installations. So we need to do a better job of working on that. The estimated median for 2016 is 8. That's probably not too far off. But if you can see, the overwhelming majority of people who are respondents are doing outdoor installations are only doing 1 to 4. And then you see rapid drop off of people who are doing more than that. Much to the dismay of all these people have outdoor speakers. Our guys need to do a better job, and gals. Questions? So we got, I said it'd be 45 minutes. We've got 5 minutes. What questions might you have? Hi, John.
First of all, great job, and so illuminating, and it's gratifying to see how the program that you both represent has evolved so rapidly in 4 or 5 years. So thank you for that. But my question, and then maybe a comment to follow, is the respondents. The pool of respondents, are they CEDIA members, or do they maybe also include some non-members?
It is not member nor non-member based at all. The only thing that we are doing is qualifying the work that they do, and then we break it down into whether you are a home technology professional only, that is your primary work, right. Or so anyone who has responded has to have at least done one job in that, what we'd call CEDIA portfolio category. So if you say home theater, you have to be, and you're an electrician, you have to be an electrician that installed one home theater
That part I got, but one more time on the member versus non-member.
We don't differentiate at all. This is our work that we do for membership is in our profit action plan, what we used to call benchmarking. Okay. So we don't break it down to.
So does that mean that the 653 is a mix?
It is.
Of members. Okay, which is good.
It's great.
And now my comment is just that what I think we're seeing as an industry is, I don't know, I'm going to grope for the words here and please work with me, but it's the evolution of how specialized a particular integrator or dealership is, whether they're electrician or AV integrator. And we're, from our company's standpoint, we're seeing no rules. You know, the only rule is there's no rules. Some companies, and it depends on where they are geographically, a company in a metropolitan area can be very specialized and very successful at the same time, whereas in a smaller market, you need to be much more diverse. And I know it's virtually impossible or very difficult to factor that into to this sort of thing. But I guess my comment for all of us is just keep that in mind, too, that it ties to Gene's question about the geographical distribution.
Sure.
There are going to be differences. But I'll just finish by saying thanks again, and this is a great presentation.
Thanks, John. I really appreciate it. Ted?
Really, I have a couple of questions. And so my first question also was about the size of the survey. There's something like, depending on who you ask, 20,000 or 25,000 integrators in the country. Is there something we can do to pick up the respondents to the survey?
Well, we think the response is fairly good. It's a solid response. Our margin of error in general is at, well, I would say, around 4 to 5%, which compared to others is okay. Great. The number of home technology professional companies only is around 9,000 to 9,500, and we're only really looking for one respondent per company. So we're almost getting, let's say, 8% response, which is a valid response rate. Would we like it to be a little bit more? Absolutely.
More respondents is more accuracy.
Yeah, of course, of course.
So I'm not criticizing.
Is there something we could do
to pick up response rate to try to improve it? And the other thing is...
Well, let me answer that first.
Oh, go ahead.
Time
so,
out.
Go ahead.
Here's what you can do for all of you reporters. Please post when we're making this open. Please write about how important it is to get people to actually participate, because our reach is not as great as your reach. So, yes, you can help
us
for sure.
How about offering some kind of pay for responder, enter into a drawing to win a system, or there are things that marketing companies do to encourage greater response.
Oh, we did. We did. I think this year we gave away an Oculus Rift and a computer along with it or something of that nature. So we did.
Okay. So then my second question was there ever a category where the actual result exceeded the projected result?
Yes, the exceeded result wasn't a category, it was a year. 2014, almost every single estimate was lower, so they underestimated in 2013 and significantly by 34% of what they did. So 2014 was that kind of explosive year. But in general, no, they're overestimating. So that's why one of the things that we are going to work on is not only doing the size and scope or the estimate size of things, we're also going to try, we'll see how well we can do it, to start doing some forecasting, because forecasting is different than estimating, so that we can get some information. But right now, what we would say is with 5 years of growth, you had 4 of those years, they overestimated by an average of, let's say, 13 or 14%. 1 year, they underestimated by 34%. And so those numbers swing wildly. But if you reduce the number by about 15%, that's flat.
That was my question.
Yeah.
Isn't there some way you can apply an algorithm to, counteract the effect of the over-optimism so that we're looking at a better number?
That's very funny. I spent a lot of time with our vendor about that. I think she got a little angry with me. But that was exactly it. It's like, and she said, look, when you do that, it is in forecasting, not in sizing. So this isn't our projections. This is the projections of the integrators. So we as the organization are going to work on making our market research so that we can do forecasting, and we will then do seasonally adjusted so that we can adjust and take out those over-optimistic numbers and try to produce a more realistic number. It's why we put our 2016, we put the little dot on there that said this is probably more likely of what's going to happen than what is being shown.
Okay, last question, I promise. Do you think at all we're seeing any level of correction? Because last year you and I talked about it. There was some very questionable numbers last year.
Yep.
Did anything get changed in the methodology, or are we seeing some kind of correction? These numbers this year look a little more normal to me.
We did not. And so I spent a lot of time with our vendor, with Parks Associates, with Tricia, because you and I know, I had talked to Tricia the last year about these numbers look crazy, and we even revised them down. We didn't change methodology. What we're seeing is that we saw that 2014 was an anomaly. So the data wasn't the anomaly, the year was the anomaly, in that we just saw this pent-up demand, it got released. In the report, you'll see that we think that most of that pent-up demand was released by the end of 2014, which is why you see a little bit of a tail off in 2015, even though we think that it's great. You just can't average 57 or 63% growth year over year. So I think.
So in other words, there's a market correction rather than a study correction.
Yeah, I think market correction is even a little bit harsh of a word to say. I would say it's more a normalizing of the market. So a correction would say that this is a gigantic swing. It's not a gigantic swing. We're talking about 2%, 3% difference in the numbers. But you're right. I think things lowered just a little bit. 2014 was just a crazy, awesome year, and I really hope a lot of our members took some of that money and put it into their reserve account.
Okay, thanks.
Any other questions, comments, or concerns? All right, well, then I will say thank you. Have the wonderful rest of the day.